morning. Welcome to North Conway Baptist Church. Let's all stand and worship the Lord together in song.
So excited to have you all here worshiping with us. Last week was an amazing Easter Sunday, but we remember that every Sunday is a Sunday that we celebrate the resurrection. And so once again today, we will turn our eyes towards the risen Savior. If you are a guest with us this morning, we're especially excited to have you here with us. And we do want to ask one favor of you. There's a Connect card. It looks just like this in the pew pocket right in front of you. If you don't mind taking just a few moments during the first part of the service and filling that out, we would love for that to be your contribution to the offering plate today. We just want to find out how we as a church can best minister to you and your family. So if you'll fill that out, we will make contact with you and make sure all your questions about this amazing church are answered. With that, let us stand together and continue in Spirit-filled worship.
seated.
As we come today to our time of focused prayer, we're going to actually look back through history to the prayers of the Puritans. The Puritans were a widespread and diverse group of people who took a stand for religious purity in the 16th, 17th, and 18th century. Their rise was directly related to the increase of knowledge to the common people that came in the Age of Enlightenment. As people began to have access to God's Word in a language that they could read for themselves, they began to see and understand that there was a deeper faith that was being denied them. The more that God's Word washed over them, the more they were drawn into a passionate and pure form of faith. The word Puritan was first coined around 1560, and it was a derogatory term for this group of people that said that worship should be pure than it was, that devotion should be pure than it was. They were a people of fierce devotion, an intimate relationship with Christ. Often their prayers were written. And in the 1970s, their prayers were compiled into a book called The Valley of Vision. As we're focused on prayer this year, this is probably the book above any other book that I would recommend that you would get. It's a collection of these Puritan prayers. It includes prayers from names that you might know, like Richard Baxter and John Bunyan, Isaac Watts and Charles Spurgeon. It's a selection of petitions and meditations that are in the Puritan tradition. They're intended to teach and to encourage us. I love the way that D.A. Carson says it. He says, "The prayers in the Valley of the Vision are steeped in Scripture, yet they never succumb to mere formula. They are theologically fresh and vibrant, yet they are rooted in confessionalism. They range over a huge sweep of Christian experience and devotion, but they are never merely esoteric or cute. They brim with deep emotion and transparent passion, but they are careful to avoid mere sentimentality. It is a book that teaches the reader to pray by example." So over the next couple of months, we're going to devote our focused prayer time to some of the prayers that are present in this book. Join me as we pray together with our Puritan forefathers. Psalms 116, verse 1 and 2 says, "I love the Lord because he has heard my voice. He has heard my pleas for mercy. Because he inclined his ear to me, therefore I will call on him as long as I live. O God of the open ear, teach me to live by prayer as well as by providence. For myself, for my soul, for my body, for my children, for my family, for my church. God, give me a heart that is frameable to your will so that I might live in prayer and honor you, being kept from evil, known and unknown. Father, help me to see the sin that accompanies all that I do and the good that I can distill from everything around me. Let me know that the work of prayer is to bring my will to yours, because without this, all prayer is folly. When I try to bring your will to mind, it is an effort to command Christ, to be above him, to be wiser than him. God, this is the sin of pride. I can only succeed when I pray according to your precepts, according to your promises, and to be done with as it pleases you, according to your sovereign will. Father, when you command me to pray for pardon, for peace, for brokenness, it's because you will give me the thing promised. For your glory as well as for my own good. Father, help me not only to desire small things, but with holy boldness to desire great things for your people, great things for myself, that they and I might live to show your glory. Father, teach me that it is wisdom to pray for all I have, out of love, willingly, not out of necessity, that I may come to you at any time to lay open my needs that are acceptable to you, that my great sin lies in me not keeping the love of your ways. Help me to see that the remembrance of this truth is one way to sense your very presence with me. Father, there is no wrath like the wrath of being governed by my own lust and my own needs. So, Father, deliver me from myself. Father, wash me in prayer and draw me ever closer to you through that experience. God, we ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen, choir. What a beautiful prayer. As we come to the time of worship through giving, we turn our attention back to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We've been in this passage throughout the Easter season, and we'll conclude with it today. But beginning in verse 42, it reminds us, "So it is with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown is perishable, but what is raised is imperishable. It is sown in dishonor, but it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, but it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, but it is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, then there is also a spiritual body. Thus it is written, 'The first Adam became a living being, but the last Adam, he became a life-giving spirit.' But it is not the spiritual that is first, but the natural, and then the spiritual. The first man was from earth, a man of dust, but the second man is from heaven. As was the man of dust, so also are those who are of dust. But as is the man of heaven, so also are those who are of heaven. Just as we have been born in the image of the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of the man of heaven. I tell you this, brother, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable." So we've already looked several times at this passage, reminding us that that first Adam is representative of Adam in the garden and represents all of us in our sin. But that second Adam is Christ, who came to remake creation. And we see the beautiful connection between Christ and us, that it is through Christ that we obtain life. And the verse closes with that verse that the perishable cannot inherit the imperishable. It's a reminder to us that the things that we have in this life, the homes, the cars, the influence, the power, the money, we cannot take it with us to heaven, but we can send it ahead in influence. As we invest it into God's kingdom, as we invest it into the gospel, as we make possible for our church to influence our community, as we make it possible for missionaries to go out around the world, so too we invest in the imperishable, the kingdom that is coming. So each and every week when we come to this time of giving, that is exactly what we're doing. We're exchanging the imperishable, the perishable that we give, for the imperishable that can never be lost. Join with me as we pray together.
Heavenly Father, we praise you. We thank you for all you've done. Lord, you've blessed us in so many ways. Now as we give back a portion of what you've given us, we pray that you'll bless the gift and the giver. We pray that you'll use this offering as you know best. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
We come now to the time in our service where our kids will be dismissed. And so if you're going to children's worship, you can follow Ms. Zoe out to my right and your left. The rest of us can begin to turn over to Matthew chapter 6. We'll get there in just a second. This year, the vision for our church this year, the focus, if you will, for our church this year is If My People Pray. We're spending this entire year focused on prayer. We started with a quote in our very first sermon that said, being a Christian without prayer is no more possible than being alive without breathing. We understand that prayer should be such an intimate part of our Christian faith that it is second nature, just like breathing. And so throughout this year, we are determined to put our focus on how we can pray more personally, how we can pray more as a family, how we can pray more corporately. And so we've had some sermons already and some activities to help us invest into each one of those. Our very first sermon, we looked at prayer's foundation. We studied through the entire book of Philippians, looking at what it had to teach us about prayer. And we came to realize that what we can expect when we engage prayer as the visible engine to power the spiritual prospering of our lives, our family, and our church is an all-encompassing peace that comes from God and will be beyond anything that we can understand. We began to see that prayer is that visible engine. It is the thing that we can do here to drive forward the spiritual nature of our lives and our family's lives and our church's life. In our second sermon, we looked at prayer's partner. We studied fasting. We looked at the fact that both the Old Testament word tsum and the New Testament word nisia both have the concept of self-denial. And so we're looking throughout Scripture, we realize that fasting is an opportunity for us to give up a worldly need for a greater spiritual need. During fasting, the believer's focus is removed from the physical things like food of this world so that it can be intensely concentrated on God. Put differently, fasting directs our hunger towards God, or most simplistically, fasting is a hunger for God. It's going without something good to intensify our need for something greater. So today we're going to continue our look at prayer. I love the fact that Oswald Chambers said, prayer does not equip us for greater works. Prayer is the greater work. Prayer does not equip us for greater work. Prayer is the greater work. When we look at the life and ministry of Jesus, there was so much that he did that was important. There was so much that he did that was good, great even. His work, his miracles, his healing, his teaching. But even beyond that, he did something greater. And his disciples saw that greater thing. And the way that we know that is when the disciples came to him, they came to him one time and they asked him for some personal insight, for some intimate teaching. And when they came to him, they didn't ask him, teach me how to do miracles. Teach me how to teach better. They came to him and they said, teach me how to pray. Because they saw in Jesus the greatest work of prayer evidenced in his life. Remember in Luke 11, 1, it says, now Jesus was praying in a certain place, and when he had finished, one of the disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray. And it says that Jesus went on and he said, pray like this. And he gave to them a model prayer, an outline for prayer, if you will. We've come to call it the Lord's Prayer in our modern times. And in about a month, we're going to actually unpack that Lord's Prayer in a two-week sermon series where we dive deeply into it. But before we do that, I want to follow the pattern of Jesus. Because if you look in Matthew, in Matthew's account of this same event, before Jesus taught them how to pray, he actually taught them how not to pray. He gave them some warnings. And so in today's sermon, that's exactly what we're going to do. We're going to unpack how not to pray. Turn with me in your copy of God's Word to Matthew chapter 6. We're going to be starting in verse 5. Jesus says, and when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites. For they love to stand and pray in the synagogue and at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father in heaven knows what you need even before you ask. Bow with me. Father God, we thank you this morning for the reading of your word. We thank you for the power that is instilled in it, that we might learn and draw out to refine our prayer life. God, today as we look at how you have cautioned us in Scripture to not pray, the things that we should avoid, Father, may it challenge us and inspire us to strive deeper in our prayer life with you. Father, we ask in the next few moments that you would speak to me, speak through me, and speak in spite of me. And God, we ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. So to sum up basically what Jesus says to them, if you were to distill it down, what he says when he's giving them these warnings about prayer is don't be a hypocrite. Don't be a hypocrite. It's interesting here that this word hypocrite here in the New Testament is actually taken from the modern culture of that time, the current cultural context. Because in the context of the New Testament, this word hypocrite refers to one that works in theater. A hypocrite was a play actor. I've done some drama in my time, and if you've ever done any drama, you know that you put on the role of somebody different. Right? You come out on stage and you are somebody else. And so what Jesus is saying is don't be somebody else when you're praying. Don't let your life look one way and your prayer life look another way. Don't be a hypocrite. William Law, who is one of those Puritans that we were talking about just a few minutes ago, in his book, A Serious Call to a Devoted and Holy Life, the Puritans were not well-versed in short book titles. He opens that book by saying, devotion signifies a life given or devoted to God. Devotion signifies a life given or devoted to God. And so he goes on in this book, written in 1729. He teaches that if God is our greatest good, then the wisest way that we can live for him, to please him, is through a life of worship, adoration, and devotion. Devotion being those things that we do for God, our service, our ministry, specifically our prayer lives. And in his section on prayer, Law says that the number one issue that hinders Christians when they try to pray is this. He makes the argument that our trouble in praying is that we pray one way, but we walk another. And so therefore we cross ourselves up, is what he says. The reason that our prayer life is ineffective is because it doesn't align with our regular lives. Have you ever been crossed up, right? Got your feet tied up when you were walking? So when I was wooing Frances, one of the ways that I wooed her was I took her country line dancing. I know that seems a little off-brand for me, but that's what we did. There was this club at Auburn, and we would go, and they would do country line dancing for like 2 hours, and then at 10 o'clock, they switched over to swing dancing. And I found that country line dancing was dancing that was made for me. And the reason that it was made for me is for two reasons. One, country people don't know what to do with their hands, and so all you have to do is you just put your thumbs in your belt loops, and you're good. Your arms are done. Half your body is done. The second thing that country people like to do is they don't like to improv. And so everything, and this speaks to my inner administrator, right? Every country line dance is just a pattern that you do over and over again, right? They love their boots, so there's a lot of heel tomping. And you just do the same thing over and over and over again. And I loved it. Like, I fit in. It was great. Except for this one dance. So there was this one dance. Most country line dancing, you stand in a, you ready for it, line, right? And so you're all kind of facing the same way, so you're all doing the same thing. But there was this one dance that we did that was this couples dance, and you did it in a circle. So the guys were in a circle on the inside, and the girls were in a circle on the outside. And so you did your little routine across from your partner, and then the guys went right and the girls went right, so you ended up with like a new partner, and then you did your little thing again, right? The problem for me is that you weren't looking anymore at somebody that was doing the same thing as you. You were doing somebody that was mirroring you. And I could not get that through my brain. My brain would not wrap itself around that. And so I ended up crossing myself up constantly. And so all I did during this dance was apologize to whoever my partner was. I'm sorry, 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 I stepped on my foot, I'm sorry, I stepped on your foot, I'm sorry, I knocked us both down. Because I would cross myself up. My feet became hypocritical to my mind, and so I stumbled. And so the problem in most of our prayer lives is that our actions become opposite to our lives, and we trip ourselves up. So let's look specifically at a few things that we should not do when we're praying. How can we not be a hypocrite? So here's a couple things. How not to pray. Well, the first thing in how not to pray is to not pray. We can avoid prayer sometimes because of deep theological reasons. It is possible to avoid prayer because we doubt that God has the ability to actually meet the needs of the things we're praying for, right? Sometimes we can avoid prayer because we really feel like God doesn't care enough for us to meet those needs, even if he could. But more often than not, the reason as Christians that we don't pray is simply because we never develop the habit of praying. So it's not for some big theological reasons. It's just because we never take the time to develop it. C.H. Spurgeon calls it getting rusty in the knees. Too many Christians are rusty in their knees. If I know anything about something that gets rusty, the only way to work it out is to work it out. We were doing a little project around the house the other day, and Anna Sky was helping me with something, and she was zip-tying some things around our little garden, and I went to get a pair of snips so she could snip off the end, and they were rusty. They wouldn't quite work. And so what did we do? We sprayed a little WD-40 on it, and then we worked them back and forth for a minute, and slowly over time, what happened? They began to loosen up. They became functional and powerful again, and she was able to go and use them for what they were intended for. We have to be willing to work at prayer. I know that might have blown your mind. So many people look around and they see prayer warriors around them, and they say, man, I wish I could pray like them. But the problem is they're not willing to work at praying like them. There's a piano teacher that was sitting with one of her young students, and they were working on their scales and their arpeggios. And after a few minutes, the little student began to kind of slump down, and he kind of got slower and slower, and then he got a big frown on his face. And he finally just stopped, and he looked, and he said, I don't want to work on scales anymore. I want you to teach me to play like Van Cleburne. If you don't know who Van Cleburne is, he's like one of the most famous pianists of all time. He won like this worldwide piano competition when he was like 23. He was a virtuoso. This child, that's what he wanted. I want to play like Van Cleburne. And the teacher smiled and she looked at him and she said, buddy, you may not ever play exactly like Van Cleburne, but here's something you can do exactly like him. And the boy perked up. He said, what? She said, you can work on your scales and your arpeggios. Because here's something I want you to know. Van Cleburne didn't become Van Cleburne without doing his scales over and over and over and over. Too many of us want to pray like Jesus, like Paul, and yet we're never willing to put in the work to learn to pray like them. And so we just don't. We see others praying more powerful prayers than we, and so we just stop. It's like an athlete watching a professional football player and going, well, I'm not like him, so I'm just going to stop. No, you don't stop. You go out and you work harder. You do it day and day and day and day. See, Spurgeon says it this way, he who often goes to a room knows how to gain admittance, but a stranger loses himself in the passage. Familiarity with the mercy seat is a great point in the education of a child of God. Be sure to gain it. Did you catch that? He that goes often to a room knows how to get there. Too many of us come so infrequently to prayer that we get lost along the way. And so the first thing that we have to do is to pray. We have to commit ourselves to actually praying. The second thing, how not to pray, is to not pray alone. The second mistake that many of us make is all we ever pray is when we're in public, right? We pray when we're at the dinner table with our family. We pray maybe in Sunday school when we're asked to pray there, but we have no private prayer life. This is completely opposite to what we see in Christ. If you look through the Gospels, we hear about him going off to pray by himself way more than we ever actually have captures of his prayers in Scripture. Yeah, we have John 17, the high priestly prayer. We have some other little quips of prayers where it says that he blessed the food before the 5,000. But so much more often, we see the reality that's in Mark 1:35, where it says, "And rising early in the morning, while it was still dark, he departed and went out to a desolate place, and there he prayed." This was the Son of God. No one in the history of the world has ever enjoyed as intimate of a relationship with God the Father. And yet, he devoted himself to constant, diligent, extended, private prayer. Mark tells us that Jesus rose early in the morning to pray there at the beginning of his ministry. Jesus prayed after he fed the crowd in Mark 6 by himself. He prayed alone before he chose the 12 in Luke 6. Jesus prayed alone before Peter confessed him as the Christ in Luke 9. Later in the same chapter, Jesus prayed alone before going up for the transfiguration. He prayed alone when the disciples asked him to teach him to pray. That's why they asked him in Luke 11, which is what started our sermon. And of course, we know that before the cross, before enduring the most horrific aspect of his life, the climax of his ministry, what did Jesus do? He found a quiet garden to pray by himself. You see, the problem is our society nowadays, it idolizes the public. But the public can have no power without the foundation of the private. Our culture idolizes the pictures we put out on Facebook and the celebrities that are in movies and singers. We idolize those public aspects of life. But they are anemic if they have no private foundation. Think if there was a husband that only ever said he loved his wife on Facebook. When he was in public or posting stuff, he posted about how great she was. But when they were alone, he never said a kind word to her. He should absolutely post those things on Facebook, but they should be founded in the private, intimate reality of their lives. Before God uses us publicly, he wants to meet with us privately. The power of God displayed publicly in Jesus' ministry flowed to a significant degree through Jesus' private prayer life. Jesus' public ministry was founded on private, personal, intimate prayer. And so we should follow that same example and not save our prayers only for when we were in public and can voice them in front of others, but they should be built on a foundation of private, personal prayer. The third aspect of ways that we should not pray is by not asking. Too often we are afraid in prayer to ask God for the things that we want. We feel uncomfortable doing that, and so we just don't. We don't ask God for things in prayer. I think there's probably three main reasons that we don't do that. I think the first reason that we don't ask God for things in prayer is that we feel bad asking because all we ever do is ask. We don't ever come to God in prayer except when we need something. And so then when we do need something, we feel awkward coming and ask because it's all that we ever do is ask. Prayer should be a full conversation between a loving father and his child. We should praise him, thank him, seek forgiveness from him, and then ask. If you had a teenage child, and the only time you ever saw them come into your room was when they're asking for money, how would you feel towards that child? Like, I know I just probably prophesied the reality of most teenage parents' lives, right? Can I have $5? Can I have $10? Hey, we're going to the movie. Can I have $20? And you give that joyfully when it's built on a full relationship. When they come and spend time with you other times, and they sit and they talk with you. But if the only time they ever walk through your room is to ask you for prayer, of course it's going to be awkward. And so it is the same with God. Luke 11, which is a parallel passage to Matthew 6, where we're looking at where Jesus is explaining this to them, kind of unpacking this prayer thing. He says, I tell you, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and you will be open. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and the one who knocks, it will be opened. And so we should ask God for things, but it should be within the context of a full prayer life. I think the second reason that sometimes we don't ask God for things is because we know the things we're asking for are just selfish. Sometimes we don't go to God and ask for the things that we want because in our heart of hearts, we know that we're just being selfish. We just want what we want for ourselves. Listen, if you can't pray about it, then you probably ought not to even seek it in your life. Remember that when we pray, we are praying in Jesus' name. It is he who has given us access to the Father. We pray through him. And so if Jesus wouldn't pray for it, you probably ought not to pray for it. Jesus goes on in that Luke 11 passage in 11 and 12. He says, what father among you, if his son asks for a fish, will instead give him a serpent? Or if he asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion? But I think we can also flip that and say, what father, if his son asked him for a scorpion, would actually give him a scorpion? The father's not going to give to the child something, even if they want it really bad, if he knows it's for their demise. James 4:3 says it this way, you ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly to spend it on your passions. And so we should absolutely come before God and beseech him for things. But they should be things that align with his will for our lives and for the lives of those around us. Thirdly, I think sometimes we don't ask God for things in prayer because sometimes we ask and we don't receive. And the reason that we don't receive is because we're asking for things that we can do on our own anyway. D.L. Moody, who is one of my favorite historical Christians, is famous for his bluntness, his straightforwardness. And one time he entered into a prayer meeting that he had been invited to, and it was a prayer meeting of some of the most influential and wealthy businessmen in the city. And he came into the prayer meeting, and there they were, knelt down, gathered around, and they were praying. He says all he could see was the soles of some very expensive shoes. But as he walked up, he heard them poring over prayer, asking God for $1,500 for a ministry that they wanted to do. And he famously said, brothers, get up. I don't think I would bother God with that request anymore. Any one of you could write a check right now and never notice that it was gone out of your account. There are times when we pray for the things that we know we can already do for ourselves. But the problem is we often match that with not actually praying for the things that we can't do for ourselves. I love the way that A.W. Tozer says it. He said, God will not do what you can do. And there is no use trying to do what only God can do. We get tangled up trying to do for ourselves what only God can do and asking God to do the things that we can already do ourselves. And so when we come before the Lord, when we come seeking him, asking him, we should ask for those things that only he can do. And the things that we can do ourselves, we should just get busy doing them. Jesus continues in that Matthew 11 passage in verse 13. He says, "If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him?" I love the fact that it draws again this analogy of a father. It invokes this picture of parenting in prayer. And so we can put ourselves into that picture when we can understand that God is not going to spoil us. He is not going to wait on us hand and foot. As a parent, there's so many things that you want to do for your children. There's so many gifts that you want to lavish on them. But if they come into the kitchen one morning and say, "Mom, will you go make my bed for me?" You're going to go, "No, go make your own bed." God is not going to spoil us by waiting on us hand and foot. He's not going to make your bed. He's not going to wash your dishes. He's not going to cut your lawn. If you can do it, do it. But there are so many more things that we cannot do. And those are the things that we should reach out to the Father for. There are strongholds in our life that we cannot conquer on our own. And that's where we should lay out over and over and over again our request to the Father. Which actually brings us to the next thing that we should avoid when we're praying, ways not to pray. The next is in not persisting. Not persisting. Too often, we aren't persistent in our prayers. We're not committed to pray over and over and over and over again for the same things until we get an answer. It's kind of back to the piano teacher and the scales again. We have to be willing to do it over and over and over again. But the beauty of that is when we come to God over and over again, asking for the same things over and over and over again, those desires of our hearts, those things that we want to see Him do in our lives and in the lives of others, as we come to Him again and again and again, it begins to bring clarity on those things that we just talked about. It's easy to throw up a prayer request to God one time, but when we begin to ask for the same things over and over again, that's when we begin to see that maybe this is something that's selfish. Maybe this is something that's out of line with God's will. Maybe this is something that I should be doing already on my own. Maybe I'm the answer to my own prayer. And as we begin to pray over and over and over again, knocking on the door of heaven with repeated requests, and sometimes we step back and go, "Well, I don't want to annoy God." It doesn't annoy Him. It delights Him. You know, I know that it delights Him because we are doing what He commanded. That same Luke passage, Luke 11, it says, "And He said to them, 'Which of you who has a friend will go to him in midnight and say to him, "Friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread, for a friend of mine has arrived on a journey, and I have nothing to set before him." And he will answer from within, 'Do not bother me. The door is now shut. My children are with me in bed. I cannot get up and give you anything.' I tell you, though he will not get up and give him anything because he's a friend, yet because of his impudence," which is another word for persistence, "he will rise and give him whatever he needs." God desires that we come again and again and again with the same things over and over and over again in prayer. Number one, because it delights him, because it aligns us with the commands he's given us in God's word, but also because it refines us in our asking. So we should pray. We should pray privately. We should ask for God for things in prayer. We should ask for them repeatedly over and over and over again. But the last thing that I want us to look at, the last way that we shouldn't pray, is by not listening. Too often in prayer, God can't get a word in edgewise. You ever have a friend like that? Have a friend like that once they kind of get that mouth motor going, they just can't turn it off, right? If you're not thinking about somebody, somebody's probably thinking about you. It doesn't matter what you want to say in the conversation, right? You can never just kind of find a crack right? That's the whole thing. Too often in our prayer lives, we do all the talking, and we never stop and listen. We never stop and yield to the directing of the Holy Spirit. Now, we need to have a full stop caveat right here, right? We have to stop right here on that and put some context around it. Because here's the thing we have to understand when we're listening to God in prayer. First and foremost, God has given us the entirety of His revelation right here in this book. It is complete. So God is not giving you any new revelation in your prayers. But what He does through the Holy Spirit as we listen to Him in prayer is He finds a way to impress these words into our individual hearts. And so then we can begin to check the things that we think we hear against the things that we can see in God's Word. You see, if we only believe that God's Word is this generic book for everybody, then we have become functional deists who serve an impersonal God. But God desires to write His Word in your heart. And the way that He does that is when we listen to Him in prayer. Paul Miller, in his book, A Praying Life, Connecting with God in a Distracting World, he says it this way: if we focus exclusively on God's written word when looking for God's activity in our lives, but don't watch and pray, we will miss the unfolding story of His work. We will miss the patterns of the divine artist etching the character of His Son on our hearts. Our lives will lack the sparkle and immediacy of God's presence. But the only way that we can do that is if we stop and listen to God in prayer. When part of our prayer life is devoted to pausing and listening for the leading of the Holy Spirit. Now, we always have to be cautious in that, because we understand that we also have a sinful nature inside of us that speaks in our ear as well, right? And so anytime we hear things in prayer, when God's speaking to us, God has given to us His Word as a check and balance. He has given to us the community of the church as a check and balance. He has given us confirmation through His character in nature, in creation. All of these things act as parameters that help us to check, is this me? Or is this God? But if we don't ever stop to listen, it's not going to matter, because we never give Him the opportunity to speak into our lives. So, application. How can you apply these things, right? We've talked now about how not to pray, but now how can I take these, how can I reverse them, and how can I invest them into my prayer life? Four quick points. First, very practical. You ready? First application. You got to go and pray. That's the application right there. You've got to pray. You got to start working on your scales and arpeggios in your spiritual life. And that comes with constant, scheduled, intimate, alone prayer time. And here's how you do this. If this is not a habit of yours, or maybe it's a habit that you need to make a better habit, right? You need to get stronger in it. Here's four simple ways. First, identify a spot. Think of and find a spot that you can pray every single day. Maybe that's at the dinner table, maybe it's at a desk, maybe it's in your car, maybe it's in the shower, wherever you're going to be, where you're not distracted or have the least amount of distractions, external distractions, and where you have all the implements that you need in order to pray, whether that's a Bible, a journal, a pen. Those are great elements to have around. And so the first thing you got to do is you got to identify a spot and prepare that spot, right? Like if you got company coming over, what do you guys do? Like this is the South, right? We don't just open our homes up, right? If you got company coming, what do? You prepare for that company, right? You pick the underwear up off the floor. You sweep all the dust under the rug, right? You get ready. Because you've got an appointment. So you need to prepare that spot as if you've got an appointment with the Almighty Father. So the first thing you got to do is you got to identify your spot. The second thing you got to do is you got to identify your time. You know yourself, you know your schedule. It's not going to match across any of us. We're all knit together differently. Our schedules are knit together differently. Some of you are morning people. Some of you are freer and have more free time in the evening. You're more focused at night. It doesn't really matter when it is, but it does matter that it is. And so you should have a time scheduled on your calendar every single day to pray. Listen, you schedule your doctor's appointments. You schedule your coffee dates with your friends, right? You schedule the shows you're going to sit down and watch. It's okay for you to schedule a time to prioritize your relationship with God through prayer. And so you need to pick a time that you can keep consistently. The third thing you need to do is you need to plan your time. So you've got a spot, you've got a time. Now you need to be the cruise director of your own prayer life, and you need to make out a schedule. You need to have a plan, because if you haven't been devoting yourself to this type of intense relationship with Christ yet, the first time you sit down and you got your spot and you got your Bible and you got your pen and you got your time, and it's 7:45 in the morning, I'm sitting at the dinner table. I guess I'm done. Thanks. No, you need to have a plan. This is where a great journal is helpful for you to write out some of your prayer requests, to think through the things that you're going to pray about. One of the great things that you, if you don't have a system, here's a great system you can use. You can pray, P-R-A-Y. You ready? P is praise. Write down some things that you praise God for. R is repent. Confess the things in your life that you need God to forgive you for and help you with. A is ask. Ask for yourself, ask for others, ask for the church. And then finally, why is yield? Shut up and listen. Praise, repent, ask, and yield. And just do it over and over again, over and over again, over and over again, until you run out of things to praise for, to repent for, to ask for, to yield for. Let that be your structure if you don't have one. Finally, you've got your thought. You've got your time. You've got your plan. The fourth thing that you need to do is prepare for resistance. If this isn't something you've done consistently, maybe you pray every now and then, but it's not something that you do daily. Maybe it's something you haven't done at all. If you plan, if you prioritize, if you commit yourself to this, here's what I can tell you. Resistance and distractions are coming. William Cooper, who in the 1700s was a famous hymn writer, he wrote, "There is a fountain filled with blood." We played it at our Good Friday service. He says this. He says, "Satan trembles when he sees the weakest saint upon his knees." And there's truth in that, but here's the other truth in that. While he's trembling, he's trying to distract you from keeping you to do it. When you kneel down in prayer, you are kicking the hornet's nest of hell. And you can expect there to be some resistance. Here's what I can promise you. The first time that you sit down to do this, your ring's going to go off. You're going to get a text message. The kids are going to start fighting. The dog is going to throw up. All of this is going to happen because Satan is trying to stop you from getting invested into a habit of the most powerful way that you can encounter God that he has given to us, prayer. And so you need to prepare for it. You need to be ready for it. You can do all you can to isolate yourself, but you just have to be ready to persist over and over and over again. Because when we begin to do that, we will begin to be changed. So it's my prayer today that you will find a way to pray. That you will find a way to pray consistently, privately, asking God for the things that you need, but yet yielding in a way that allows you to listen to him. Use these application points to start that. Today, during the invitation time, we're going to sing a song like we normally do, but we're going to sing a different song. We're going to sing a song we learned the last time that we had a sermon on prayer. It's called A Christian's Daily Prayer. And so today during the response time, here's what I want you to do. Pray. We're going to be singing these words, but these words are a prayer, just as much as if you were bowed in your living room by yourself praying them. And so what I want you to do is I want you to do exactly that. I want you to enter into a time of prayer. Here with 300 of your closest friends, you need to be alone with God. Sing these words as a prayer to Him. Stand as we pray together. Father God, we thank You. We thank You for the tool that is prayer, that allows us to encounter You, that allows us to come before Your throne room, Father, that allows us a deeper, more intimate, more powerful relationship with You. And so, Father, today, encourage us, inspire us, challenge us to go deeper in our prayer life. And Father, may it start right now with this prayer. Thank you so much for being here. I want to draw your attention to just a couple of things. Don't forget to be praying for our Guatemala team. The flag is over here. They come back this Wednesday. We're getting great reports so far from their efforts down in Guatemala. Continue to pray for them. I also want to let you know that at the end of this month, the last Sunday of this month, is going to be our mission focus for this year. And so our further Sunday this year, we're going to be focused on Compassion International. We're going to have a lot of great opportunities. We're going to have a guest speaker with us that day. We're going to have a virtual reality experience that you and your family have an opportunity to do that afternoon. You're going to have, we're going to have some more information coming over the next couple of weeks, but just go ahead and mark your calendar for that amazing opportunity last Sunday of this month. And then, of course, we can't leave without talking about how amazing last Sunday was. Last Sunday's Easter services were incredible. Thank you for everyone that helped in the children's area, the choir, everybody that did the things they needed to do so that we could host so many people from our community. It was a glorious day, and we praise God for it. So with that, thank you so much for being here today. Go out and pray. You are dismissed.